Yeah, my name's Reece Terris, it's right there, and the whole talk's going to be about, centered around my artwork, but more specifically the process of how I get from point A to point B, and what's really interesting for me is the middle part, where I'm actually thinking through the work. Oftentimes I'll have an idea or some kind of inspiration, and it's not always clear how I'm going to get there. In doing this talk about process, I had to ask myself, well, what is process? And it's more than just going from point A to point B and going, well, this is a project and this is my process. It really, for me, thinking back, it really came from where I grew up, like Trevor said, how I grew up, and what my education was. So it's all about life experience for me, and being fairly physical with what I do for work. I'm a builder, contractor, and It's come down to this sort of haptic quality, this analog learning through doing. And I think Sarah mentioned earlier this idea of muscle memory. So what happened, to give you some anecdotes, when I was a kid growing up in the 70s, we didn't have iPhones, and we were just starting to get shopping malls. And so where we live, we played in the bush, and we stole lumber and construction materials and put them on the back of our wagons, and a group of kids would wander off into the bush and with hammers and saws and tools, and we'd make tree forts and half pipes for our BMX bikes and skateboards, and that was our day-to-day activity, and we'd come home when it got dark. And it was a kind of a perfect childhood, and I grew up in Port Coquitlam, which is, at the time, 30,000 people, just a really rural area. That quickly became a rather ugly suburb, in my opinion. So what happened was, I went from this doing and making and go-karts and scraping my knees and whatever else like most kids do, to actually trying to make money doing a similar version of the same thing, which is carpentry. So I'd be up on a roof, putting a roof on, or building a wall, or whatever, working as a carpenter, or thought I was a carpenter at 17. And I'm sure I was quite useless, but I was still banging away with nails and boards and hammers and saws, and still very physical. What really changed for me was in my late 20s, I decided to go traveling, and I left my suburb, my little haven, and traveled all through Europe, and was really enamored with all the galleries and architecture and everything that we don't really have here, or at least I wasn't aware of here. When you travel, you take a bit of time out, and of course you have a little bit more room to just think and read and take care of yourself and investigate other things that you normally wouldn't. So as I traveled, I became really interested in architecture and visual arts in particular, and I applied to Simon Fraser University and got into school. So to back up, when I was working in these suburbs, it wasn't like one homeowner had a design and wanted to execute something original or different. It would be like in a development by Genstar, which is sort of the residential equivalent of BOSA, or like our condo towers here. So everything started to become very homogenous. We'd be working in suburbs that had four colors, so you could pick forest green, or you could pick aubergine, or you could pick beige. And so after a while, you were just like in this system and working through this series of colors and plans, four plans that were the same or reverse plan. And there was this thing that I didn't quite understand, but I could feel it. And I think it was pretty obvious, but I'm like, well, what is this? And I don't I'm complicit in this moment and in this doing, but I'm not really invested in it. There's something that doesn't feel quite right about it. And so this long preamble introduction is about that way of growing up, and that way of growing up really became part of my process. So going to school gave me the opportunity to learn this language of visual arts, and it sort of became an awareness. I started to become aware of the way the city was built, and knowing how to build things, I realized how plastic they were and wondered why, as a society, we're making certain decisions about one thing or another thing, especially when we execute city plans or parks or condominiums or waterfront or whatever we're building. Wonder why that's built that way, and I started to be able to question it and able to recognize what I was looking at, and then I started to push back against the things that I wasn't so interested in seeing in the world, or things that I wanted to question in the world. So the first piece I want to talk about, I've got two pieces when I was a student at SFU, and the first one is more of an activist work, and it's about that sort of becoming aware of what's in the city and why it's in the city, and you know, might have passed it 1,000 times before, but was never realized the impact that this sort of benign object had until I started to understand what's going on. So the first one's called Union Gospel. Union Gospel Mission is right on the corner, I think, of Cordova and Princess, and it's on the way to Alexander Center School. And these stones were embedded in the sidewalk all the way around the property. And they're anti-loitering devices. You might see this in railings where they've got the little nodes on the railing so skateboarders can't use the city in a certain way, or on benches where they've got sort of unnecessary armrests so someone can't lay down and have a nap. So what these things do is they really prescribe the way that the city can be used. And I went in, so part of the process here is being a sort of an activist piece and not so much a piece about making something. Was more about just talking about the function of the building and the odds that it was projected to the public, where they were asked to come in and have a meal and maybe help get cleaned up or reintegrated into the city. So I took these out as a gesture after speaking with the director, and they took all the stones out, and we sort of flattened out the slab and made it a little more welcoming and a little more humane, and then had an awning around the building so people could stand out of the rain and feel a little more welcomed into this thing. So this is just about becoming aware, part of my process as being educated. The next one's American Standard. This is my graduating piece. And this is just an idea of the way I think. And so this is a bathroom on the fourth floor of the men's washroom. And I wanted to build a fountain, and I wanted to riff off of Duchamp's urinal fountain piece. And so I thought, well, what a great idea. During Christmas break, I'll come in here because no one's here. Everyone's away on holiday, and I'll just think through this bathroom. So there's me taking notes. And this is sort of the point of no return. I always love this moment. It's when I know I'm committed, and then even if I want to go back, I can't really go back. And so I kept the three urinals in the back and basically went through the process of thinking how I'm going to execute this this pool and fountain on the fourth floor. And so this is just a public washroom in the SFU studios. And so all this stuff that I'm trying to show you here quickly, because I'm probably taking up too much time, is, you know, this is going to contain the water, and how am I going to adjust the floor? These are the maquettes for the urinals. Change the high pressure plumbing to a low pressure PVC system. And this is a manifold where a pump would hook up to the bottom of that, and it's closed off. And anyway, all this goes through the wall. I'm tanking out the floor. And there's a lot of weight in there, but at the same time, I'll have it engineered. I'll core a hole and make sure that no one's going to die. So I always go through the process of making sure the structure is going to be okay. So there's a lot of figuring out going on here for me, and the red stuff is like a membrane. I've raised the heater so no one gets electrocuted. Actually, I've disconnected out of the panel and I tiled the wall, and this is the final piece. So this was so on the left you can see a little pump, the little gap in the wall where the water recirculates through, and it was a a really great experience for people to come in, you hear the rushing water, and get sprayed with yellow water. And people would walk out and use the washroom, and it became an event. So, anyway, that's that piece. It has a lot to do with, you know, if you look back on it, I mean, it was a great exercise for me. And taking the photograph is really difficult. It was like a 30 view camera from a 4x5 cameras lined up with the back grid for perspective. And there was a lot of work to actually make these photographs work because the piece doesn't exist anymore. This is when I took it out and took the urinals away and put it back how it was, except it's a nice, fresh, white tile bathroom. It has a lot to do with art theory, which I don't know if we have time to get into now, but it also was a lot of fun to do and to figure out. And there was all kinds of arguments when the building manager found me ripping into the building. This next one, Trevor, I think, mentioned, this is called Bridge. This is a piece that I conceived of in a really odd way. A house on the right, this little maquette, is my house, and my office is there, and I usually sit up there and work on the computer, and you can see how close the two homes are, and I'm like, well, there's something about this orientation where one house is back and one house is forward. It's a bit unusual. And my neighbors had just moved in. I didn't know them, and I was standing up on the deck, and my cat was on the railing, and I said, listen, I'm an artist, and I always wanted to build a bridge over to your house, and the roof isn't very good, and so maybe now's the time. My cat jumped off the railing, and only this far, and they're like, okay, you can do that. Because, you know, even I thought that, like, maybe it would just be a 2-foot plank from one building to another, but there was something interesting about the connection and the proximity. And so I sat for a few more months, and they went away on holidays. And but I still hadn't figured it out, and I kept looking across to their deck. It's so like a renegade kind of unsanctioned, unpermitted deck. I mean, the deck is so oddball with those giant posts, but there it is. There's East Van right there, and I'm like, well, it's about this sort of connecting two leisure spaces. So they went away, and this is the real thing. And the model was actually built afterwards as a way to represent the piece, not just through photography, but this was open and people would go through the fence. You can see here, they would go through the fence and up over the bridge and into my house. And I'd come home from work and people would be on the bridge or in my house or on my house or in my house. when they came home from holidays, luckily we became really good friends. And I wasn't sued. I'll show you a few more photographs of that. That's an alley view. You can see the city in the background. And the neighborhood that actually allowed something like that to happen. This was unpermitted, of course, this bridge. And there it is from the park. This is in process. And this is... it's all about like a view from the top. Like when you start to think about it, the whole piece was about this transgression of a property line, a boundary. So there's a sort of spectacular quality to the work, but the work, in my opinion, always is trying to do something else. The work's trying to show you an overview of the condition that we're in or what we've accepted. And so you see house after house and barbecue after barbecue and plastic chair after plastic chair, and everybody's mortgaged 30 or 40 years of their life to those little postage stamp lots, including me, because I'm living in one of them. So it's interesting when you pull yourself out of that and you can see through this sort of imaginary crossing of a boundary what's going on and how you're a part of that. And so that this became about Vancouver real estate and about property lines and about fences and about borders and about how communities work or don't work. This next one is a photographic series that came at the same time that I did a piece on apartment. I've only got a few more to go here. And so this interior views is a selection of homes that our company were involved in demolishing and other companies were involved in demolishing. And all this material I was collecting, I just kept going, well, these doors are fantastic. I'm gonna take them and build a cabin in it, but I don't have anywhere to build a cabin. So I had all this stuff. I just wound up with years and years worth of things and bathtubs and things. And I kept them out of my uncle's barn in Langley. And this process of collecting, as I just couldn't throw it away. Like we throw away so much stuff that's good. It just reaches this moment in time where people don't want it anymore and want to do a renovation. So this is like a really nice home, but you can see that there's some finger paintings on the wall, and it's about to be torn down, and something else is going to be constructed. So it's about this moment where things are in flux, where they've gone from being highly valued to valueless. And I was always interested in that shift in materials, because there's no change in the materials, just a change in thinking. And there's a staircase here from the, I think the 70s, and some homeowner built thing that's pretty fantastic. So I'd collect that kind of stuff. And eventually I had so much stuff that I said, well, I'm not going to build a cabin, I need to do something with this. And I made a proposal to the Vancouver Art Gallery to build a six-story apartment tower inside of the rotunda of the gallery. And to my surprise, they were interested. So I kept collecting stuff. And this is like a 90s living room in Richmond. And what I'm really after here is, it looks like a really banal photograph, but maybe it is, but I'm really interested in the surfaces where we've gone from one kind of material to another. And this is like a click-together engineered floor that lasts for 5 years. And so I'm interested in the surfaces of things and why we change from one way of building to another way of building, and how the surfaces get used and what they mean ideologically. So this is the culmination of that process of collecting. So this is the cross-section of the tower, or the rotunda, by Arthur Erickson during the renovation of the Vancouver Art Gallery in the 80s. It shows the scaffold that I proposed to go through the center, and all the crosshatch areas are areas that I'm going to activate with the sculpture or installation. So I'll just blast through this. This is the barn from about halfway point. My uncle had a turkey farm, and now defunct, and so he had these barns, and I asked him if I could build a bunch of apartments in his barns. So I thought it would be a great idea to use these pallets as a way to stage the piece, like to build everything horizontally for the tower. And I found out very soon that I couldn't use this recycled material, that I was really bound by the system of using new material, because I had to pay so much for the labor to put these disparate materials together. So you can see on the left all the pallets, and on the right all the new material. And then so the piece sort of already informed itself while it was in process about why we're stuck in this system already. It's a really big investment for people to use reclaimed material. Like if we work for people who want to do a home out of reclaimed material, well, they'll do it, but that will cost them 25 or 30% or 50% more, just based on finding the material, making sure it will work, and working through that material. It's a lot harder to do. So this is part of the process here where I'm working on the staging for the piece. So what you see there with these white walls is the actual Vancouver Art Gallery. So I measured the Vancouver Art Gallery out, put it on the floor that I just showed you, and that's all the walls in the gallery within an eighth of an inch. And the line that you see, the pipe, is describing the line of the concrete staircase going up the rotunda off the first floor. And the curved wall, the stud walls that you see, are just a big jig to take that line and pull that curve. So that curve is really important, because the whole piece was prefabricated in the barns, and then taken out and shipped over to the Vancouver Art Gallery and installed. You can see the one cabinet's cut, so that's sort of part of the process. Just like, it's really enjoyable, this part of it, because I'm trying to figure out, like, I have no idea what I'm doing. I'm almost reverse engineering where I'm going, and I'm like, well, how do I make sure this is like this? And then, you know, for me to figure out to bend the pipes or to describe this staircase was kind of a exciting moment. This is the stuff I collected. It's like a barn of madness. There's every bathtub, every color. I could have done the piece in many colors, but I'm just going to go through it really quickly here. There's draperies from the 90s, the 70s, the 60s, the 50s. It just goes on and on. So the whole piece is a post-war critique on production and consumption. So after the war, when we really got invested in these regeneration and design and fashion went out over, say, utility and function, and we got locked into these sort of cinematic decade moments where that's the 50s, that's the 60s, that's the 70s, and it's funny how things just started to coalesce materially that way. The green line describes the opening in the Vancouver Art Gallery. This is some walls that were very set deck style walls, which I learned how to build. Very much important, because I'm representing the materials as themselves, so the configuration of the material is really important. This is one finished set. This is the 1960s, which has the panel, the teak paneling, the built-in television, and you can see the sort of Haynes manual cutout on the bathroom, which is and the S on the floor described with the tape. So what's happening there is I'm trying to think through the space horizontally, but imagining it vertically. So the one cutout is where your head would be if you're standing at the landing, and it brings you in a way into the building or into what I want you to look at, and then all the details. So viewpoints and visualization and all the points of view are really important. The barn that I was building it in collapsed, and I just went to bed for many days, and a friend of mine, Evan Stewart, he called about 50 people, and we all came, and a lot of them in the audience here tonight, Warren, my business partner, Greg Snyder, a few others, and helped me pull this stuff out of the snow before it started to rain, and we put it in another crappy barn, and then I rebuilt it in 1000 Parker. So this is it in the Vancouver Art Gallery. The floor is all completely reclaimed. It's a great story. I asked for the fridge there in the corner, and the guy said, yeah, you can have the fridge. And I knew they were going to demolish the house, so he came back a week later, and there was no house. I took all the everything. I took the floor, I took the bathroom, I took the tiles, and he goes, what in the fuck? And then I blamed it all on this friend of mine who couldn't speak English very well. But he didn't understand what I meant, and I just wanted him to take the fridge, but he took everything. And then I was really sorry. The guy was okay with it. This is the 60s bathroom. This is the 60s looking down, and you can see that we've integrated the carpet into the staircase, so we're pushing into the architecture of the Vancouver Art Gallery and trying to activate all the space, not just like the thing as an object. So we're like, there's a real mix between the architecture and the architecture I'm presenting within the space. So it's a real integration. It's the 70s jammed up into the coffered ceiling. And that's the 60s kitchen. I could go on and on. That's the 50s, 60s, 70s. This is looking down into the 70s from the 80s. I like this sort of collage effect that's happening where you can sort of see the process of things. And all this material is slated for demolition, the wallpaper. That's my moment. Stereo, there we go. I just cut it in half. But all this stuff was ready to go to the junkyard, and it was just a corrective way for me to take the stuff out of that stream and represent it as itself and to go through it. So this is the actual Vancouver Art Gallery floor, where we've carpeted over the floor. That's the tile and the marble. It worked really well with this sort of neo-deco 80s stuff going on in the curves and the mirrors, and with the sort of neoclassical background of the gallery. So a couple more. Here, 90s, videos, 2000s, and this was donated by Schneidero. They had a display suite, so we were lucky to get the 2000s. Okay, so I've got, those lights are turkey brooding lights. They come down and they warm little chickens, little turkeys. And so it was a way to take the sculpture up into the rotunda dome. And so it just didn't truncate it, it didn't stop, it kept going. This is second to last. This is the Western Front, front of the false front. Trevor did a great job of explaining it, so I'm not going to say too much about it. Basically, it took me a year to figure out what to do there. I was invited by I think Candace Hopkins, who was the curator at the time, said, "Well, we really like your work on the bridge. Can you figure something out for this?" And I really couldn't. And I guess back to process, it's like just sitting with things and letting the subconscious take over, or your unconscious mind, where you're. You know there's something there, but you're not sure what. And finally, you hit upon it. I'm like, well, it is about this sort of Western vernacular and architecture where we've got these false fronts. What is that? Like, why do we have those? Is it for cowboys to go shoot guns behind? Well, it's not. It's sort of like this psychological cue that you're downtown. If you're in a muddy track and there's like a little boardwalk, these larger than life facades behind a tent or whatever. I'm sure you've seen Vancouver photographs where they've got like a log and people are selling land out of a log, or there's a tent or like a little facade in front of it. Well, this is real boomtown architecture. And for the Olympics, it made perfect sense, in my opinion, to put another facade on a facade. So, and there's the boardwalk in front of it. You can see the before and after. And so it's called the Western Front. Another false front. And the boardwalk is a really phenomenological thing. It's a very important part of the piece because the thing was installed in a day. So the boardwalk is this thing where you're actually walking and you clunk along the boardwalk and you're like, what is this boardwalk doing on the sidewalk? And that's like that's this thing to try and make people aware. Like, you watch people walk, and a lot of them look down, and they look right here, and it's an interesting way to try and activate all of that architecture. It was taken out here because the city was upset that there was a boardwalk, but they didn't notice the... Which was okay, so... here it is and there we are putting it on. So that's a bunch of friends again, and those are receiver poles, and we drop that on, and that's all engineered, but not permanent. There's no way. I actually called the city for this piece and said, listen, they're like, yes, and then I paused, and I hung up. So what am I supposed to ask? So, this is the last piece I'll talk about. We've got to do a question and answer. It's called Goodbye Work, and I was invited by Philadelphia sculptors to a really depressed town called Frankfort, just outside of Philadelphia proper. And it's a super hardcore area. It got hit really hard by the downturn, and the place that I was working in, it's slowly being gentrified. There's an investor group that bought a dye works factory. It was called Globe Dye Works. And that place was a family-run business that had been run for 150 plus years. And they went out of business in 2005, and then these investors bought the place and thought it'd be a great idea if they brought 9 or 10 artists from all over the world to do an installation inside of this factory to sort of generate interest in it, because they were turning it into artist studios and apartments. So not being there and not being able to get inside of it, I could look on Google Earth, and I figured out this idea for an anagram. So this is on top of their water tower, and there's the Globe Dye Works, and you can see there's a map of the world, and it's sort of ironic that it's Globe Dye Works, and there's the globe, and then they all went out of business because of globalism, because of this sort of global capital and offshoring. So the whole piece is about the neighborhood, and had a lot of great talks. Like, outside of this large factory is a bunch of row housing. You can see that I've changed the words. I've moved the B to the D and took away the L and put another O and took the E off and the S off. So it went from Globe Dye Works to Goodbye Work. And so it was quite personal for a lot of people, and a lot of people had guns. So more just being conversational and getting along with people, and it was a really strange neighborhood, but I really liked the people there. And they, you know, when you're working there, they're like, don't go out after dark, and it's kind of weird for me to hear that, like, you know. I mean, so anyway, I was out after dark, and it was okay, I came back. But so this is another portion of it. This is an old deco entrance, and it's the same sort of strategy as the Western Front. It's down low, and I want to make sure that people understand there's something going on up top as well. So there's some rusty steel from inside of the building that I took and did a reflection of the Globe Dye Works into Goodbye Work. So it's activated at street level and ground level and on the upper area. So, and there it is at night, and the commuter train could see it coming back and forth. So this is quite high, and you could see it from the railway tracks. And so, yeah, that's my talk. I've got other things to share, but I don't have enough time. So thanks a lot for coming, and it'd be really great to be invited.
Question for Reece. You gotta start with Billy, way up there. Okay, no, this is gonna be fun. No, I really am hurt for this.
More like you're caring.
Hi, Reece. Hi. Audrey was talking about all the different things you're creating. Firstly, we think you must have a very understanding partner relationship.
Yeah.
And neighbors, obviously.
Pardon me?
And your neighbors. Yeah. Very kind, very generous.
Yes.
Question we've got is, what happens with all this stuff? Because we all want to go and see that exhibition with all this stuff.
Right.
So where do we go?
Well, I had a big garage sale. I had it in containers. You know, as an artist, you think, oh, my career's going to take off. And I had it in containers. And it was supposed to go to the Venice Biennale of Architecture in 2010. But it was just a conversation, but it never happened. And so I kept it kind of got my hopes up, and then I said, oh, I gotta get rid of this stuff. Like, you wind up with this massive amount of junk. And it's not just junk, but it's stuff people could use. So I had a big garage sale this summer and sold it all off for like $5 for a beautiful credenza, a whole collection of old records for a dollar, all the glassware, whatever you wanted, and then the rest of it I just tossed it all. So that's where that one ended up. They all kind of ended up there.
There's also something sort of temporal about your work, though.
Yeah,
it's there, it's a moment in time, mm-hmm. There's a conversation, and then it's gone.
Yeah, it's for me, the work really matters, that it's inserted into the dialogue. It's in dialogue with what's going on in the city, and I think through photographs and talks like this, a proper documentation and catalogs or essays, and Greg's written a lot of them, it has a life and it will continue to remain in people's memory, and I think that's what's important. It doesn't matter so much that it exists as an object anymore.
Right.
Yeah.
I have a question. So all of your work that you've done is temporary installation, so that brings me to the question of your creative process. Do you work, is it all on your own? Do you work with other people? So if you were to do something more permanent within a municipality or a city, mm-hmm. is that a thing you've ever done, or would that affect your process of working?
Yeah, well, it's sort of a two-part question. I just did my first public installation. That's on the corner of Comox and Broughton. And that's for West Bank Developments. That's, you know, SB. And I think Stan Douglas did a piece here, the Gastown Riots piece. That's through West Bank. And they've worked with a lot of great artists. So I was really lucky to get that commission. So that's my first one. And it's this permanent thing, which is interesting. But it's not really my modus operandi. It's just the nature of the work. It's not like a little object or two-dimensional piece on a wall in a gallery that you can take home and put above your couch or, you know, whatever. Like, I mean, they're big. They're not all big. Like, I do lots of little stuff too, but the things that I'm known for and what I talked about here is larger and really is difficult to just store or deal with in any way. But it does affect my process in terms of how I work and where I think I'm going to do it. I mean, even having access to the barns or when it collapsed, we built all that in 1000 Parker, but in the garage, I took over the whole garage. So it's like a parking garage. But yeah, I work with other people as well. To answer your question, I'd have to. I mean, it's so large. Like on my apartment, I probably had 30 people over the year and a half build. And now it's like about a 3-year process. Like that was 3 years collecting, planning, building, and nobody really knew what I was doing until we started to lay these suites out. They were like, oh, I get it. And I'm like, well, we've been talking about this for years. But it's, you know, it doesn't matter what you draw, sometimes people just need to see it, right? So, but yeah, it's fun to work with people in general.
Oh, God. This is my workout. This is exactly what I look like in the gym.
A lot of your work is quite disruptive of space or environment or systems and conventions. And what I really enjoyed during your talk was how you actually never talked about how you ever thought about, oh, I need to go ask the city or I need to go ask this building. And so I'm wondering where you got the audacity and bravery to do that.
I don't know. I don't know if I touched on it, but I was really, in school, I was really into situationist theory, like Guy Debord, and one of my favorite artists was Gordon Mana Clark, and I don't know if you know his work, but he was a guerrilla artist who would go into industrial sites and buildings and actually chop them up and turn them into sculptures, and so people would come back from the weekend and the building would be like torn apart or split in half, and then they would threaten to arrest him, and I really liked that. Just took on the world as material, right? I was once asked where public art starts for me, and it starts outside my front door, or that's where it all starts. And I think that being able to like make a rift or a fissure in the city and actually have some agency in that whole process is part of the important part. It's not just like asking for permission and sanction this or that. And I try to emphasize that I make things safe, or you know, like they're engineered and someone's on the hook for it. But that's an important part of it, but I think if you're going to make a comment, you can't qualify the comment. You have to say, I really want to say this thing, can I say it? And it's like, well, you just say it, you know? And I think that's all part of it. Like, I think having the drive to do it and doing it are really important. And I think if you have to ask if you can do something, well, then maybe you're not really doing anything.
Better ask than forget enough.
Yeah.
I need to do this by sectors. Quadrant one.
Hi. Hi.
I personally thought that was fantastic.
Thank you.
Basically, what you were talking a little bit about kind of reverse engineering and having to figure things out as you go. I know for myself, when I come to a challenge, I just give up. How do you push through that?
I don't know, like a lot of times, like when the barn collapsed, there was a lot of friends that came to help, but also I was so financially on the hook personally that if I stopped, I was just going to go bankrupt. So it's like, well, either you go bankrupt or you figure a way. And I don't know, sometimes it's more that I want to see this stuff happen. And like for that project, I remember when the Vancouver Art Gallery said yes, I'm like, great. And then I couldn't sleep for months, and I was like, how am I going to build this thing? And I'd get up and just, you know, hit the wall or whatever, you know? Like, so it's just a matter of, like, it all kind of works out eventually. Like, I think you just have to trust yourself enough, or pretend to trust yourself enough. I think one of the things that I always do, and Warren can attest to this, like, I always say, oh, that's going to take a month. And it'll take, like, a year or 6 months. And I think fooling yourself is really important. Yeah. And you're just like, oh, this is nothing, I got it. And then, once you're down the track, you kind of can't stop. And like when I was talking about that point of no return, that really is true. Like when you smash something apart, well, you've got to put something back. So you might as well put what you want to be there back. And so there's always this point where I'm like, okay, I know it's really not going to be a month, but I'll fill myself just enough to get over that hump, you know?
There's the tweet of the day, huh? It's important to fool yourself. Lord. It's already 10, folks. If you have to leave, please forgive us. We're going to run long.
Hi, I think you said on one of your projects you had about 30 people who were helping you.
Yes.
I was just wondering what it is you do to inspire people to help you, because I'm assuming you can't afford to pay all of these
people. No, I've paid them.
Do you?
The bridge, I had a lot of friends help. Like, that was an after work kind of thing, and I think I made some really good friends on that project where they just came to help, and they thought it was crazy and wanted to just see what would happen. And it's small, right? But a lot of apartments, like a job, like, I mean, people that worked there were working there. And I'm sure they hated me at some times, like, oh my God, he's nuts, or he's an asshole, or, you know, it wasn't all roses. I mean, it was a grind. That piece was a grind. But they all kind of have their grindy moments, but I like to pay people so that I can really get on there.
I'm sort of curious about two things, your critical purview and your creative process and the relationship between the two, because you had some interesting kind of things that surfaced up during your talk, one of them being about surfaces and material. There was a post-war critique of production, this kind of thing. So, and thinking about your VAG piece with these decades, particularly giving it a lot of your work is temporal or ephemeral, I'm wondering about what those decades mean to you, what that historical trajectory is all about for you.
Sure, yeah, I think it's really interesting, like in our business, like my contractor side, what I find fascinating is where there's this real push, like, you know, in the 30s and 40s, maybe the 50s, to like age, like the age of the client, to do something. And then there's another time when we'll go in and fix a sink or something, and it's like a time capsule where people have given up, keeping up with the Joneses. And I love walking into that kind of stuff where people have said, you know what, I've done enough, all this stuff works, I don't need that anymore. It's sort of this maturity and where people are doing other things with their lives instead of constantly distracting themselves with home renovation or whatever it might be, you know. And I think, you know, that may sound a little too heavy-handed, because, I mean, I'm renovating my house right now. There's a lot of truth to it. I mean, there's nothing wrong with making your place good, but I like when people just say, and it's good enough, and I think that's really important. So, you know, now everything is so prescribed that people will move into a place and rip it apart without living with it, right? And I find that really interesting. I think that's more psychological than anything else. Like, I think it's like, you know, HGTV or whatever that is, but there's this thing that we've gotten plugged into that's actually dictating how we act. And I think my position in my work really exemplifies that. Like, I see it all the time. So, like, oh, here's another person who I say, don't do this renovation, and then they hire me. And totally fine, because I need to work, but I said it, and I didn't do the job. So
it's strange, but to go back to the piece, like the decade thing, which is really exciting for me, was like doing all the research, and then you see there's things like, I don't know if I'm getting this right, but it's the International Color Consortium, and they're going to figure out the color palette for the next 10 years. It's like, so people start to think, well, I really like this color. It's like, well, do you really like that color? Because, you know, it's been handed to you, right? It's like paddling. You get to pick brown because it's fall, and you get to pick green and yellow because it's spring. So there's this real interesting...
grammar.
Yeah, there's a parameter that you're choosing between. You're not really choosing. You don't even know what you're choosing, I think, in some cases. So I find that really interesting that it's like a personal expression, but it's the same as every other expression. So, you know, it's this sort of systematized culture and systematized way of consuming that seems like you're making a choice, but you haven't made any choice at all. Also, the last point with what you're talking about, with these decades, it starts to really associate it with film and how things become like My American Cousin, or things become really time capsules, you know? Like you can look at things and you can look at colors, and that's like a process of this thing that's happening underneath, this subversive offering, right? Or this offering that you've selected, and then you start to, you look back and you can really see that, you know? It's really interesting to see how compact and compartmentalized everything is. So.
And you're interested in disrupting that and drawing attention to the phenomenological field?
There's a ton of stuff going on in that thing. Like, I mean, there's a Bible and there's a Quran in the bookshelf, and there's like all this stuff going on. It's a big jumble all the way through the piece, right? So it just depends how you look at the objects and see what they're saying. But the whole show is curated. I mean, there was a hard abstraction show on that time with Frank Stella, and the top of the walls were turned into a monolithic curves and things that were riffing off of that. And on the other side, you had like a Donald Judd, and there's a Dan Flatton. And you turn around and there's one white cube, but took the window out and made it a cube so that it was relating to the Donald Judd. And so there's this sort of curation going on within the gallery, but then there's this curation going on with the dialogue within the objects and the piece. So it just goes down a rabbit hole.
We're gonna have one more question up here. We have to wrap up and get everybody on with their day. So make it a good one, Carolina.
Hi, Reece. Our group, we were wondering, how do you finance these projects?
I pay for them myself, typically. The only one that I got a lot of help on was the Vancouver Art Gallery, but that was like a fraction of what it cost to build a piece. So I used my life savings for that piece, and that's part of the reason to your question, like why I carried on, or I had to carry on. So, you know, I really was going to go bankrupt. So, I don't know, I really wanted to see stuff happen, and if I do want it to happen, I'd rather spend my money on that than a new TV or whatever. I'm really bad with money.
Do you sell some of the pieces?
I have like all the Vancouver Art Gallery owns some of the photographs, so there's photographic documentation as for sale and a series, but I've never really sold anything. No,
if you do a book, I'll buy one.
Yeah, okay.
We'll all buy one.